Okay, friends, so let's start this session. First of all, I want to thank each one of you for being here, and for maybe if you are part of India, early morning, and if you are other part of the world, you know, greetings to you for the day. And we're going to discuss the concept of governance, especially the program governance, and how the program governance help organization deliver benefit, manage benefit through the program initiative. Okay, so let's begin the session. Now, a brief about my profile. I have over 20 years of management, portfolio management, project management, program management experience in training, coaching, consulting domain. I am a guest speaker in various management institutes and universities, where I spend my time, and I you know, I share the knowledge what I have gained over many years of my professional working and through my training experience. I am PMP certified since July 2007 and doing the PMP training since then, once I became certified. Thanks to many people who gave me opportunity to share the knowledge. The list is endless, so I will not discuss each one of them here. I'm also PGMP certified, which is called Program Management Professional. This is another certification from PMI. And today's topic is more aligned to this subject or this certification, which is called Program Management Professional Certification. But it is not a certification webinar as such. We are just going to cover the concept of program governance, not the entire content, but you know, the but the few of the concept from the standard for program management. I'm also portfolio management professional certified, and I am PMI ACP certified. So these are the four certifications which I have done of PMI, and then Microsoft certified professional in enterprise project management. I'm a Microsoft certified trainer in Microsoft Project and Enterprise Project Management tools. I am Train the Trainer certified from Dale Carnegie, ITIL, CSM, and some of the other certification which I have done. So that's a brief profile about me. Now let us begin the concept of, first of all, what is program? And then we will cover how governance, how program governance can help in program deliverables, in producing the program deliverables, and in how it supports in program management. This is what we will cover in detail in this webinar. Let us understand what is a program. As defined by PMI, program is a related project. Program has related projects. It has subsidiary program and program activities managed in a coordinated manner to obtain benefits not available from managing them individually. So if you could see in the screen, I have highlighted two keywords in this definition. Now, program is defined as related projects. So these projects, subsidiary program, and the program activities are called program components. Okay, so in the standard for program management, they are called components. So component can be a project, can be a subsidiary program, and can be a program activities. Okay, what is program is, you know, it is a related projects, subsidiary program, and program activities. And this related is a must to have constraints. They must be related with each other. Okay. And what is the program deliverables? why we doing, what is the various purpose of the program is to obtain benefits, and the benefits for the organization. Okay, this benefit should be aligned to the organization goals and objective. So the program deliverables are called benefit, and these benefit probably you may not able to avail if you manage these projects and other component of program in individual or in silos or in a discrete element. Okay, so program management is all about delivering benefit for the organization. Now let me give you an example to explain this definition in more detail. Now friends, let's understand a problem statement. We have a problem because every program which we start in our organization, it definitely has a need. Now what is need? Need is either a opportunity which the organization has or a need to solve a problem. So either a problem statement or an opportunity statement, this is called a need. And because of this need, organization comes up with the concept called program. Okay. So now here, let us take an example of a problem statement and how this problem statement can transform into a program, and how you know, this program can deliver benefits to the organization. And this benefits align to which organization goals and objective, how to derive the benefit from the goals and objective, that is what we will talk in this particular session. And then the importance of governance in you know, approving these benefits, in supporting these benefits, and in you know, multiple governance activities, roles, the principles, that's what we will discuss in this particular webinar session. Now, if you could see a problem statement here on the screen, 94% of US crashes involve human errors. Okay. There are 42 hours wasted in traffic annually per person in the, again, in the United States. 3 million American age 40 plus are blind or have low vision. So these are the multiple problem areas which an organization has identified. And to overcome this problem area, they came up with a program, and using that program, when they solved this problem, they achieved their organization objective. And let us understand what could be the objective for which they have, you know, identified this problem, or how they solved this problem, what benefit they got by solving this problem, and you know, how it contributed to the organization. So now there are three problems. There are 94% crashes involve human errors. There is a 42 hours of human efforts gets wasted into a traffic annually per person. And there are 3 million American age 40 plus have low vision or they are blind. Of course, this is a research where, you know, it's not my hypothetical problem. It's a real problem which has been, I have taken from the internet, which I assume is the real data. Okay. Now there is a company. There is a company called Google. Okay. Google identified these problems. Okay, and then they came up with a concept called autonomous drive. Okay, what is autonomous drive? Autonomous drive is a self-driving car. Okay, a car without having a driver. Now, Google started, when they started this this initiative, they called this as a Waymo. There is an autonomous drive platform called Waymo. It's called you know, W-A-Y-M-O, Waymo. This is the autonomous drive car started, which has no driver, and it's able to solve all of these problem statements. Okay. And what is the tagline of Wemo? The tagline of Wemo is, we are creating the world most experienced driver. Okay. We are creating the world most experienced driver. Though there is no physical driver. So what Google came up to solve this problem, that there is a human errors, 42% all of these accident are, because of the human errors. Okay. They are maybe drink and drive, or they may be text and drive, or there may be many such reason, whatsoever the reason, but it's because of a human error. Okay. Of course, the blind people cannot drive. So then that's another challenge is, if they have a low vision, so this is what the problem the Wemo solved. It's a self-driving car, which they started. Later on, Wemo become part of a company called Alphabet, which is the parent company of Google. So it became 100% subsidiary of Alphabet, rather than being a product of Google as such. Okay. And Wemo is a successful initiative by Alphabet, and in America, in few of the region where people can book a Wemo car, and where it will, it's just, and Wemo is just a software product. Google or Alphabet, whatever they initially started under Google, then Alphabet it became subsidiary. Whatever we call it, it's a very successful, where people have started using it. It's a software project only, where you can just like a Uber as a service. There is a mobile app which you can book, and you can put your current location, your destination location, and the car and the cab will come. Whatever you can buy a different luxury car, hatchback car, sedan car, and the different model which you can choose, and it will pick you up, it will put you, it will transport you to your destination. This is what is the Wemo program, basically. Now, this program has multiple projects. The first project which is also called a component, is GPS and lane mapping. That Google had to, they already have a Google map, okay? So this was the existing component Google have. They don't have to create the map from the beginning. That really helped even in this new program, which is called Autonomous Drive. Okay, they already have a map which was integrated with the global positioning system. Okay, of course, GPS is not of Google. GPS is the government GPS. The United States government has owned the GPS, and the map is using those GPS and so on. So that's a one project which they have to they need as part of this autonomous driving platform. The second project is the speed limit. Okay, when you're sitting in a Wemo car, this car should know what speed the car where you're sitting is running, what speed the other car in front of you is running, what speed the car from behind is coming, and the different. So because it need to know the speed limit to avoid such accident, and ensure that when to overtake, when not to overtake, and when to allow the rear car coming from the rear side to overtake. For that, it needs to know this particular speed limit and so on. So that's the second project, perform independently. And remember, friend, these projects within the program, as I said, they don't have start-to-start relationship, or they don't have finish-to-finish. As there are four type of relationship you have between the project, which is called finish-to-start relationship, start-to-start relationship, finish-to-finish relationship, and start-to-finish relationship. So these car, it depends upon the program manager, upon the dependency and other factors within the organization. They can decide which project will run first, which project will run next, can the projects run parallelly. So, and it depends on many factors, where some of the project, if there is no mandatory or a hard logic, then they can run start to start. or they could be finish to finish relationship as well, where any project can start at any time, but they can finish in a specific sequence and so on. Okay, so that's a component two, which is called speed limit. Component three is implementation of AI services to identify traffic signal and road signs. Now assume this, you are sitting in a car which don't have a driver, and there is a red signal, or there is an amber, or there is a green signal. How this car will recognize the what is the current status of the signals? Okay, when to stop, when to slow down, when to drive faster. So one of the component for this Waymo initiative, this Waymo program, is to know that what are the signals and what are the road sign. Where is there is a, you can take a U-turn, where can you take a left turn, right turn, where can you park the car, where can you stop the car. You know, the road signals are very important to recognize. Okay, so that was another project which was part of this particular autonomous drive program. Fourth project is sensors and camera integration to identify object. Now, of course, this is again a very good project. It needs to have sensors so that you know how close is the object in front of you, left side of you, right side of you, on top of you, what objects is on the road, and coming from the backside. So to know these objects around, you need to have a sensor. It needs to have a camera. Like when you are driving a car, your eyes can see everything, all the object, and you can sense sometime that, what the other driver going to do. Is he willing to take, he wants to overtake you. In this autonomous drive, this camera and sensors will do the job which a human does with his own eyes and so on. So this is the another project, and let's assume we have component 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It can be any number of component. This is just an hypothetical example. I'm trying to build it here. Okay. Now, they are related components. The definition of program is related component. If you see, these components are not related with each other directly. Okay. Like component 2 and component 3, not at all related. So then why are these components part of a program? See friends, this related keywords, when we saying the component in a program are related, and they must be related, but the relationship between the component is not of funding, not of some technology, not because of some common resources, maybe processes and so on. The relationship between the component is to the benefit. They must be related to the benefits which the program has to deliver. Okay. And even if any one of the project gets completed in any sequence, this program will not able to deliver benefit until all of these component gets delivered in a consolidated manner. Okay. So the related keyword, when we said the program component are related to each other, so the relationship is of not because of the same technology, same funding, funding organization, or a same sponsor. The sponsor may or may not be same. Each of the project may have different funding sources. Okay, somebody from the debt-based funding, equity-based funding, and so on. They may use different type of resources, including human resources, processes, and so on. But ultimately, they are related with the common benefit. All of these projects are very, very important to achieve the benefit for that particular program. Okay. So this is what is the program. It has multiple components. They are related to each other with the benefits. Now, let us go and talk about what is program governance, okay? And why program governance is important for that particular program, and who are the various roles and responsibilities who will help us in governance activities in delivering the benefit for the organization, okay? Now, as defined by standard for program management, program governance is, it enables, program governance. If you could see here, I'm really sorry. Program governance enables and perform program decision-making, establishes practices, support the program, and maintain the program oversight. So what is program? Let us understand that. What is program governance? Okay. Now, program governance is all about making decisions. Okay. Program governance is all about, establishing the various practices, the various processes which will be, involved during the program management, during the program lifecycle, which will help to deliver those benefits. Okay. So program governance is all about taking decisions. It's about establishing practices that support the program and maintaining the program oversight. So what do you mean by oversight? See, oversight basically means, friend, that, continuously monitoring, continuously supporting the various stakeholders who are involved in the program, and ensuring that the program is aligned to the organization's strategic goals and objective, ensuring that, the various investment and fundings and the resource utilization, they are all performed to deliver the benefit and optimizing these things. So these are the concepts we will discuss about the program oversight. Now also, program governance comprises the framework, functions, and processes by which a program is monitored. So governance means the various framework. We'll talk about the various framework which you can use in your program. It could be any industry framework, can be adapted from any industry or from your own aligned to your organization industry framework. The various functions which will be involved in the program, this could be different organization unit and processes by which a program will be monitored throughout the life cycle, from the start of the program till the closure of the program, how the program will be managed, how it will be supported to achieve the organization's strategic goals and objectives. So governance means taking decisions, providing framework, processes to monitor the program, to manage the program, and to ensure that the program remain aligned to the organization's strategic and operational goal. Now let us understand when does program governance starts. Friends, program governance starts much before the program starts itself. Program gets authorized during the program formulation phase. Of course, program lifecycle, we are not going to talk about the program lifecycle here, but as per the standard for program management, there is a phase, or you can also call sub phase, called formulation, where the program gets formulated. Okay, where the program business case get prepared, program charter get prepared, program roadmap get prepared, and so on. But governance exists even before the program gets formulated. Okay, it is the program governance board. It is which is also called program steering committee, which gives you this organization strategic goals and objective, and it assigns a program manager. It assigns a program sponsors and assigns a program manager who creates such business case, who justify whether this program should be continue doing this program, should be invest in such kind of concept, which is maybe looks very, very difficult, having a driverless car, having an autonomous car. So organization has to do lots of research, market research, and will the user or the customer will like such kind of car where it has no driver, and also this is all we will be done as part of the program formulation phase, when we'll develop the business case and the other artifacts. So governance board exists even before the program gets formulated, who assigns the program manager, the program sponsors, and who give the initial investment to prepare the business case and to justify the existence, that should the organization invest in the program, will the organization be able to get the return on investment, you know, all that thing will be done. Yeah. Now, let us talk about the governance model, how the program will be governed, what are the various aspects of the program governance. This is what we will talk about in the program governance model. Okay. Now, you definitely need a model, just like you need to have a risk model, you need to have a schedule model, you need to have a quality model, you need to have a procurement model. Similar way, you need to have a governance model, and this model will ensure that the program able to deliver the benefits which are derived from the organization goals and objective. Okay, so what is this model? So in the program governance model, and remember friend, this governance model is part of the governance plan. Okay, of course the initial model will be there during the program formulation phase or the initiation phase, but this model will be progressively elaborated during the planning phase. So during the planning phase, where you will create the program management plan, which will have subsidiary plan called governance plan, and in that governance plan you will have this model documented. Okay, so governance model is part of your governance plan. Now the first aspect of the program governance is your program governance principles. Okay, now governance principles, we'll talk about what are the principles which will guide us throughout the program lifecycle, how this principle will help us delivering the benefit, that is what we will talk. The governance model will have governance structure and composition. The structure and composition, we'll talk about whether this governance is aligned, what layer of governance, what number of people should be there, who should be the participant in the governance board, in the steering committee. That is what we will talk in the governance structure and composition. Then governance roles and responsibility. We'll talk about the different roles of governance, whether governance is only done by the program governance board or steering committee, or the program manager, the PMO, the project manager, whether or the program sponsor, what are these roles and what is their governance responsibilities? That is what we will also talk in this session. Okay, so what are the different roles, what is their responsibilities of each of the role for governing the program? Remember friend, every stakeholder ensure that they do some kind of governance toward the activities assigned to them. Governance is not just done by the program sponsor or the program manager or the PMO or the steering committee and so, but every stakeholder has some governance responsibilities. Okay, even when you do a program for an external customer, your customer is your stakeholder. Okay, what is the responsibilities of your customer to deliver the benefit for him and for your organization? Because if you are doing a program for a customer, even in that situation this program, you are the performing organization and customer is customer is external to the performing organization. Even in that case, when you select the program in your organization, it should be aligned to your organization strategies. It should contribute to your organization goals and your organization objective. We are just talking about a profit-making organization. Suppose you are working as a profit-making organization. You only do program or any development effort, develop any product or any services you do that product and service development and you're trying to get benefit, not because it's going to benefit them, but it have to be aligned to your organization strategies, your organization goals and objective. Of course, your performing organization who is doing the product or service development work for the customer, your organization will not get the benefit until the customer don't get benefit. Okay, customer not going to give you the entire, let's assume the benefit which you're trying to deliver is just a financial returns. So customer not going to tell you, okay, this is what is your total investment and this is your X 20% is the your profit margin. It's not going to give you in advance. It's going to give you as the milestone gets completed or when the program gets completed. So you need to ensure and customer needs to get satisfied. Customer should able to get the benefit from your deliverables, from performing organization deliverable. And in return, you will get the benefits and so on. Okay. So we'll talk about what are the different roles, what is the customer role, what is the customer responsibility for the program governance. That's what we will also talk as we go more detail in this webinar. We'll also talk about some high level governance activities. Okay, what are the governance activities in your program? And we'll also talk about some gate reviews criteria, which we can also call, there are multiple decision gates, stage gate, phase gate. What are the different phase gate, stage gate or decision gates? Where is the criteria? Of course, these criteria are part of your governance plan. Okay, your governance model should ensure that every phase gate or every decision gate has criteria so that the decisions are not taken based on subjective basis. It should be based on the criteria which everybody should have buy-ins, so that everybody agree and support the program. Okay, so gate review criteria are very important. And as part of the governance model, we need to have an escalation process. Now, why do we need this escalation process? Okay. See, remember, friends, your in your program lifecycle, you have so many stakeholders. You have your vendors. You have your program team members. You have multiple component managers, project managers. You have your customers. You have your sponsors and PMOs and so on. Escalation process is very important. How should the escalation should happen from projects to program, programs to the governance till the program governance level. So that process is very important. And also we'll talk about the various defining the authority level. Okay, which stakeholder had which authority. All these things we will talk in this governance model. And how, when you have this model, I hope you by now you're able to understand defining a robust governance model helps ensure that, all the stakeholders are engaged, are collaborating and supporting the program objectives or the program deliverables. So this is what we will talk. Let us move on to the governance principles. What are the governance principles which we have? Yeah. So program governance principle. These are some of the high level principles which you can see in your screen. The first principle of governance, which will help ensure that the program continue to get funding, program continue to get investment. That is what we will talk as in the first principle, okay? So the first principle is program and its constituent projects are aligned with the organization strategy. So this is very important principle. See, every organization has a strategy, has a strategic goals, strategic objectives, and the program, the overall program and the projects which you perform as part of this program, which we have let's take the Vemo example again. There's so many projects, so many components which we have, okay? This component should contribute to the organization strategy, should align to the organization strategy. You cannot do a program effort or multiple projects in your organization if it is not aligned to your organization strategy and objective. Very simple example is, let's assume that you working in a software company, you know, strategy is around developing a software product or any kind of software product. If tomorrow a customer comes to you and asks you as a software company that kindly, can you create a refrigerator for us, refrigerator, or can you create a product called, air conditioning for us? So, you know, this is not aligned to your organization strategy, because your organization strategy is in about software related product and services. Okay, you may create any mobile product, mobile applications, or any other software as a service you can do. But so it is very important that whatever program you do, okay, and whatever projects you do as part of your program, they should be aligned to your organization business, business plan. It should be aligned to your organization strategy. That is very, very important. Even as part of add-on skills, you know, we are into learning and development and certification service provider. Okay, if tomorrow somebody tell us that kindly come and can you develop a software application for us? Okay, we will say no. It's not that we can't develop. It's not that we can't hire. But add-on skills, the very strategy behind add-on skills, it is, you know, it's all about work, you know, into training and into consulting, into management consulting. This is what is our business strategy. Okay, this is our business plan. So we only work around this particular domain, consulting and training domain, not software development domain or by or maybe outsourcing or human resource consulting. That's not our domain. Okay. So remember, whatever projects you do in your program, you need to ensure that they should, throughout the program life cycle, should be aligned to the organization strategy and the organization objectives. The second principle which you could see here on the screen is expected benefit are in line with business case. Okay, remember friends, whatever benefits which you identify, which you derive from the organization strategic goals and objective, it should contribute to that organization goal, goals and objective. It should, there are benefits, if it is benefits to a individual, to a program manager or to a sponsor or to a CEO, which are not aligned to the organization, then that's not the right benefits which we are, because this is what is also called ethics and professional conducts. Why PMI put this part of project and program management? Because whatever benefit, if you as a program manager knows that you are working in some program which delivering some benefit, but this benefit is not aligned to the organization goals and objective, then probably you need to highlight that you know, that to your right team, who will take care of ethics and professional conduct related team in your organization. So remember friends, then this document, business case, the business case aligns your program benefit to the organization strategies and objective. When the, you know, when you as a program manager, you identify benefit, you justify the benefit using this artifact called business case. And when you submit the business case to your steering committee or to your program governance board, okay, the governance board looks whether, yes, what are the benefit, what is the cost to deliver the benefit, what is the timeline, how much time it will take to deliver the benefit, what are the risks to deliver the benefit, does the organization has capability to deliver the benefit. So all these things will be done by the program manager as part of the business case. Okay, along with the various stakeholders. Of course, program manager not going to create the business case all alone. He's going to collaborate with the steering committee, sponsor, the customer, and the other stakeholder available during the program formulation phase, and going to develop a business case, going to identify the benefits, going to justify the benefit, the timeline justification, the cost justification, the revenue which we will get, or the benefit, other financial and non-financial benefit which we will get, what are the risks to deliver the benefit, all these things will be presented by a business case. So remember, friend, the benefit must have its justification in a business case, and the business case should be approved to charter the program. So approved business case is an input for formally authorizing a program in your organization. Okay, so it is very much essential that your program benefits are in line with the business case for that program, and the business case is approved by the program steering committee, which is also we call program governance board. Now, the third principle is level of risk to the benefit. Throughout the program lifecycle, not only during the business case preparation or a charter preparation, you will identify the risk. Okay, of course, when you develop the business case for a program, you also identify risk, because your steering committee going to ask you, okay, we could see that the cost benefit ratio is very good, but do we have some risk also? What are the risks which we have in delivering this benefit? So this is what you need to justify, and this risk remaining to the benefit throughout the program lifecycle should be a governance principle. Every meeting, either a health check review meeting or a phase gate review meeting, as a program governance stakeholder, the different stakeholder need to continuously see what are the risks to deliver the benefits and so on. The next part is approved program and project management processes are followed. Now, it is very important that, throughout the program, whatever processes, whatever the tools, whatever the templates has been used, only those processes, those tools, those templates are used in the organization. I'm sorry. So friends, you may come from a different organization, but when you're part of current organization, you need to follow those organization processes and policies within that particular program or that particular tool. You cannot say that, in the past organization, I have used Primavera. Now I can't use the SharePoint or the Microsoft project. In the current organization, you need to follow the tools, the template. You cannot say the risk register template or the contract template or the various benefit register template which you will use of the last organization. You have to use whatever template, whatever processes, communication processes, the risk processes of the current organization, which has been approved by this governance team. So that's very important, very much important to ensure that approved processes, approved tool, approved templates are used throughout the program lifecycle by the program manager and the program management team. Another principle which is very important also, the funding to be utilized efficiently and effectively. That, whatever funding which we have secured, this is the primary role of a sponsor, which we will talk in next slide. The sponsor has that responsibility to secure the funding from internal or external organization sources, okay? A program can be funded 100% from within the internal organization, internal sources to the organization, or program can be 100% funded from external to the organization, from the bank loan, from the the equity, by doing joint venture. So there could be whatever funding, but once the funding is secured for the program, this funding should only be used for the delivering the benefit. This funding should not be utilized for a personal benefit or for a personal purpose. That is what the governance responsibilities or governance have to ensure throughout the life cycle of a program. Last but also very important, customer satisfaction. As I said, friends, customer could be internal. Many times you do program work for your own organization, but it is for a different, you are a program management team. the receiving function in your organization could be any operations function for whom you're doing a program, okay? For whose problem you are solving through a program management work, because program work starts with a problem or with an opportunity, okay? You're trying to leverage the opportunity, you're trying to solve the problem, and you know, by solving the problem or by exploiting the opportunity, you're going to get the benefit for your organization, okay? Customer, even if internal or external, you need to ensure that whose problem you are solving, they should be happy, they should be satisfied. That's a very important principle which you need to keep in mind. You should not define your own metrics which are not agreeable by the customer. The metrics to measure the program benefit, to track the program benefit, should be jointly agreed. You know, their method for measurement should be agreed. So customer satisfaction is very important. As I said, you know, if my customer are not happy, my organization will never able to deliver a benefit. Even in my training, assume if I'm not able to make my people happy through my training deliverables, or I'm not able to make them satisfied and certified into whatever training they attend from add-on skills, probably our organization goals and objective will never going to get achieved. So ensuring that your organization will only able to deliver a benefit when you able to deliver the benefit to the customer, and for delivering, you need to satisfy them. The customer satisfaction is a very important principles. Quickly, we'll talk about the governance structure and composition. Okay, what is the program governance structure? So this is very important concept. Remember, friends, your program governance, your program is part of either a portfolio. Of course, there could be a standalone program. If you could see this screen, okay, your program may have some standalone program, which is directly done by the governing body as a standalone program, which may not be part of any portfolio. That situation can very well exist. It could be some very sensitive program within the organization where they don't want to involve too many people. Only the governing body among them, they assign somebody as a role of a program manager, and they ask him to create the business case and then try to implement the program and so on. So that situation can definitely exist. But the more common situation is program is always part of some or other portfolio. Okay, a very rare situation where you know the program is in a standalone, which is directly done by the governing body of the organization, which is not mapped to a portfolio. So friends, your program is directly mapped to a portfolio. A portfolio may have one or more program in your organization, and there may be multiple standalone projects as part of that portfolio. And portfolio also has operations. Operations means ongoing operations. Just like project and program has defined a start date and end date, but your portfolio don't have an end date defined upfront. Okay, of course, many portfolio will end because of many reasons. When the organization strategy change, the portfolio may be killed. Okay, but when we start any new portfolio, we don't start the we don't define the end date of that portfolio very upfront. But we may have some kind of idea that what are the various conditions in which portfolio may have to be terminated and so on. But let's assume that your program is part of the portfolio. So it is that portfolio. So who is the steering committee or the program governance board? The program governance board is nothing but the representative from your portfolio, who going to govern not only one program which you are doing, but all the program in your organization. Okay, and this structure is the best structure in your organization. There can be a dedicated, like in a standalone program, there could be a dedicated steering committee or a dedicating governing body. But assume in a portfolio environment where a portfolio has multiple program, maybe 10 program, 20 program, in that having a common governing body, as part of the portfolio, it makes more sense. And that is what the standard for program management says, that having a dedicated committee is not, and what are the problems? Let us also discuss as we go further, what are the advantages of having a steering committee which oversee multiple programs? Okay. Now, one advantage, if I tell you that a portfolio, if has multiple program, a steering committee which oversee multiple program in your organization, the one objective is, you know, they can, let's assume with an, again, an example, consider as part of a program, you you are a program manager. As part of developing a business case, you identified some high level component while part of developing the business case, you identify some, because even the initial benefit realization plan, how will you realize the benefit, what kind of benefit, what kind of component you may have in your program, you may have to explain this to your steering committee. Even when part of that thing, or let's assume while during the planning phase, when you mapping the benefit to the program, mapping the component to the program benefit, and you seeking the approval from your steering committee that these are the component which we need to initiate to deliver the benefit. If similar kind of component already exist in the same portfolio, so what will happen? You don't have to reinvent the entire wheel again. You don't have, you can optimize your resources, you can save the organizational resources, which is the drawback of having dedicated committee. Assume that in your program you have a dedicated committee where you presenting your component to your steering committee, which doesn't know whether similar component has in the portfolio, then you may have wasted the resources in again doing the similar effort which is already being done in that particular portfolio. Okay. And remember, friends, your program may have, it is very well can have some component which are intra component and some component could be inter component. What do you mean by intra component? Intra component means all the component which are performed within your single program. There is no component. Component means project. With no component which can exist outside the program. Okay. Intranet, you may have in your organization, you call intranet. Intranet means all your policies, processes, which are only for your organization, which you put into an intranet portal. Internet means outside. Anything which you want the outside, like, you know, your website address, which had internet address, okay, not intranet. So there's some information which you want everybody to see, okay, the various news. So some information. So similar way, also let's take another example. In a bank, consider you transacting some money from one Citibank account to another Citibank account. So that's called intra-bank transfer. And when you transfer the account from, let's say, Citibank account to the HSBC account, okay, that's called inter-bank transaction. That transaction outside the bank. So what I'm trying to tell you, intra component basically means, intra means within the program. All the component of a program, all the projects of a program are being performed within the program life cycle itself. Okay. But there can be, when you have a steering committee, which is at a portfolio level, program steering committee at a portfolio level, they can tell you that why are we doing this component as part of this program? Similar effort is already being done in the another program. Why can't we use that component at whatever time you want? We can have that relationship, inter-component relationship, and we can optimize, we can save the organizational resources. So that's very, very important that, you know, if your committee is a common committee for overseeing all the program, that is what it will really get benefited. Okay. Now, if you could see the screen, there are some governance, we have mentioned some of the governance responsibilities. The portfolio which will oversee all the program within that particular portfolio, they will provide the governance control. They will control, they will provide the governance oversight, they will provide the decision. So this is the hierarchy. the program will be part of a portfolio, and the portfolio team, which is also, you can call it program steering committee. The program steering committee will provide you the various decisions making, will take decision in related to approving the business case, charter, program management plan, and so on. They're also going to handle your escalation. They're going to recommend changes to your program, the strategic changes to the program, and so on. So this is the will come from the program steering committee to the program, and similar way from program to subsidiary program and subsidiary program to project. Each lower level, they will provide all the governance oversight, governance responsibility, what we have already said, making decisions related to the portfolio team will take decision related to program. The program will take decision related to subsidiary program. The subsidiary program will have projects. They will oversight, they will govern the projects within that particular subsidiary program. In return, your subsidiary program will provide a benefit to program, and benefit program will provide benefit to the portfolio. So if you could see the B, one of the output is benefit capability delivered. The program, whatever benefit the program will deliver, it will be aligned to the portfolio strategy and objective. Okay, let's say you are working in a technology portfolio, and most of the case in technology portfolio, your CTO, Chief Technology Officer, may be the portfolio manager, and who may initiate multiple program in the technology portfolio. Okay, and one program, let's assume like a data center migration program, or maybe cloud migration program from a traditional data center structure to a cloud based data center structure. That is the program. They will, using that program, they will deliver benefit for the organization. Okay. And along with that, in that portfolio, it may have multiple other program, okay, maybe new software language kind of program, or maybe there are many program in that technology portfolio may run parallelly, okay. So the program steering committee, which is at this portfolio level, and the head of that particular program, which nothing but your portfolio manager, your technology CTO, is going to going to give you all the funding related to that particular program. Whether the CTO will get the funding from internal finance team or from external, that is what is the sponsor responsibility. But this sponsor will secure the funding and will give it to for that particular cloud migration program and so on. And you as a program manager, when the cloud migration get complete, you will able to deliver the benefits for that particular portfolio and so on. So you may request many changes. Change requests may come during the program lifecycle as part of that cloud migration and so on. And C is basically from projects to subsidiary program. Only difference between program and project is a product or service. If you could see, the program provides benefits, program or subsidiary program provide benefits to the steering committee, whereas the projects provides product or services by which the benefit will be delivered. So projects delivers either a product or a service or any other knowledge. And when this product and service is transitioned into the operations using the program management activities and program management responsibilities, then you will get the benefits, and that benefits ongoing operations where the benefit will be continuously realized. Remember, friend, this ongoing operations is part of the portfolio. The portfolio will realize the benefit which are delivered, the capability which are delivered through the program management work. This benefit will be realized into the operations by the portfolio in the ongoing operations and so on. Okay, but yes, this benefits has been delivered by the program. The program management work will ensure that the operations team has will able to realize the benefit as an ongoing basis, and the portfolio will ensure that the benefit continue to fund that ongoing operation, so the benefit continue to come for the organization. So this is the high level structure of the governance. Your program governance is aligned to your portfolio, your project governance is aligned to your program. Most of the time, your project sponsor is your program manager. Your program sponsor is your portfolio manager. Of course, as I said, your CTO may assign anybody as a sponsor in your program. Need not that he will owning the sponsor responsibility himself, but that situation can be possible. Okay, but most of the time, your program sponsor is from your portfolio team or portfolio, and the sponsor also chairs the steering committee of that particular program. Okay, now let us talk about the various governance roles and responsibilities. Okay, I'm going to take your question toward the end of the session. So friends, please note it down if you have any questions, okay, which I'm going to take toward the end of the session. Okay. Now, first let's talk about the program sponsor. What is this role and what is the responsibility of a program sponsor toward the benefit management of your program? Okay. Now, program sponsor, as I said, it can be a portfolio manager. Okay. If a program is part of a portfolio, then most of the time a portfolio manager may going to take a role of a program sponsor. And remember, in your function, like a technology function, you can have a multiple program sponsor also. It's not that one function has only one sponsor. So, of course, overall sponsor will be the head of that particular function, like as I said, CTO, or maybe if you are sales function that, or a finance function, that maybe CFO. But, you know, it may have multiple individual project portfolio and individual program in that particular portfolio. So he may assign a sponsor in for every program, and his responsibility in that particular program is to ensure identifying the right program manager who has the right capability to deliver the program benefits and so on. So program sponsor will assign a program manager. Program sponsor will secure funding for the program from internal and external sources. And remember, friend, it is this sponsor who is, as per the standard for program management, who is ultimately, who is accountable for delivering the benefit for the organization. It is not the program manager who is accountable. It is the sponsor who assigns the program manager, who allocate funding to the program. It is that role who is responsible for the and accountable for delivering the benefit for the organization and within that particular portfolio. Okay, so some of the responsibility is assigning the program manager, ensuring the funding is throughout the funding is sufficient for the program, providing funding at the right time. So these are the various program manager responsibilities. Program sponsor is directly part of your program steering committee. In fact, he most of the time chairs your steering committee meeting. He's the ultimate accountable for benefits. So that's why he's the chairperson of the making decisions and overriding the decision taken by the other member of the steering committee and so on. He has that power to override the decision. Which, of course, you know, if every member of the steering committee is against one decision, if as a sponsor you go against that decision, you have that power. But will it help? That is what you need to understand. What is the situation where you need to go against them? That should be, this role needs to understand that. The second role is the program steering committee. Okay. Now, this is the steering committee which will have the decision-making power. Only those people should be a part of the program steering committee which has the decision-making power. Okay. Because the primary responsibility of the governance board is taking decisions, authorizing the program, component throughout the authorizing the initiation of a program, closure of a program, initiation of a program component and the component closure, all these decisions will be under the purview of the program steering committee. Okay, so these people needs to have the knowledge of and they are the cross-functional people. They are not in part of this particular program. They are not only part of one particular knowledge. They are the cross-functional people who are able to take decision related to funding, related to risk related decisions, related to financing decisions, and so on. So steering committee is set up cross-functional people who has authority to take decisions, and this is the committee who is collectively will take decisions. Okay, like a business case approval, like a program charter approval, like a program component approval, these decisions are taken by the steering committee, not alone by a program manager. Okay, see, just take a situation that just give me a minute, please. So friends, what I was saying, that the decisions will be taken jointly. Okay, imagine in your organization, you want to take approval for some resource. You want to hire one more resource as part of your program team. You directly go to your sponsor, or let's say to your CTO. Okay, suppose you are part of a technology team. So you need to justify why we need, or let's say you go as directly to your CEO, okay, and you ask an approval for an additional resource. Okay, your CEO will say, okay, I can't take the decision alone. You need to first tell me, why do we need that resource? First take the technology approval, the maybe any legal and regulatory team, if we have their approval, any finance team approval, and then only the sponsor, your CEO may sign that decision. So sponsor may not have capability, or even if he has a capability to take decision, in that case, also collective decision making is always recommended in a program. So decisions are always taken where everybody has buy-in. Then it is far easy to deliver the benefit for the organization, rather than one person take all the decision on behalf of that particular program and so on. So steering committee has all the responsibility to take decision. Of course, in the steering committee, program sponsor is part of the steering committee. Okay, let's talk about the program management office, PMO. Now, is the PMO part of the program steering committee? And what is his governance roles? See, friends, as I said, to perform program governance, you don't need to be part of the program steering committee. It is not that only those role who is part of the committee will take the governance or will support the program governance. As I said, every stakeholder of a program has some or other governance responsibility. What is PMO responsibility? PMO has to ensure that all the processes are standardized across the portfolio, all the program in that particular portfolio. Okay, PMO need to ensure that the right matrix to measure the program success to be defined. Okay, PMO need to ensure that the right templates to be provided, like benefit register, like risk register, stakeholder register, requirement register, change register. You can also call change log, benefit log, stakeholder log. communication log, providing the tools, what tools every program within the portfolio should follow the same tool, so that, you know, the consolidation at a portfolio level is much easy, and optimizing the tools and training to the program manager and the program management team to ensure that the program manager is capable of delivering the benefits. That is the responsibilities of the, that is the governance responsibility of a PMO. And he is not part of the PMO is a support function. He don't have authority to take decisions. And as I said some time back, only those stakeholders should be part of the program steering committee, which has authority to take decisions. So PMO don't have authority to take decisions, but they have responsibility of a program governance. How will they govern the program? By continuously providing the better processes, better tools, better support to the program manager and the program steering committee, by training the program team. This is the governance responsibility of a program management office. We'll also talk about the program manager. The program manager, now, is he part of the program steering committee? And what is his responsibility? As per the standard for program management standard, program manager is champion for change. He make changes in the program to ensure that the benefit are optimized for the organization. Okay. Now, again, program manager is not directly part of the steering committee. He can't take decisions. Of course, program steering committee may authorize him to take some decision, but can he approve the program business case? Can he approve the program component, a new component which he identified to exploit some new benefit? Can he, without taking the steering committee approval, authorize that component? No. Do a program manager needs to be part of the steering committee to ensure the steering committee able to take decision? That is also not required. Okay. And imagine where the steering committee is a common steering committee in your all the program in your portfolio. If every program manager become part of the steering committee, then it doesn't make sense. And it is not required that, you know, to take a decision. The program manager, if needs any new change, if need new change by initiating a component, because change is requesting a new component. Change is requesting a termination of existing component. If program manager has to recommend some change, he need not to be part of the committee to authorize that change. He can provide all the impact assessment. He can provide his point of view, his support, his alternative options, what is the primary option, and then the steering committee will take a decisions and so on. So program manager, as per the standard, if you read the standard for program management, chapter 6, it relates to the steering committee. It provide support to take a decision by doing the multiple impact assessments and so on, by preparing the business case for a component, and it present the business case to the steering committee, basis which the steering committee will take decisions and so on. So program manager is not actively part of the steering committee, okay? But he also has the governance responsibility of a program. His governance is ensure that the interdependency between the projects is properly managed. His responsibility is ensure any escalation from a projects within his program are managed. If he can manage, if those he can further escalate the escalation from projects to the program steering committee also. So managing the escalation from the projects, that is his responsibility. Primary responsibility of a program manager is transitioning. When each and every project in your program has produced their deliverable, whatever incremental product or services, integration is the primary responsibility of a program manager. He will integrate all of these components into a cohesive whole and ensure that the entire cohesive product or consolidated product get transitioned it to the operations team. It is the program manager who will create that transition plan, the sustainment plan for that operations team, to ensure even after the program get closed, the operations team able to sustain the benefit, able to continuously realize the benefit. So that is the governance responsibility of a program manager. Similar way, project manager. Project manager primary response governance responsibility is, you know, they need to deliver the incremental product, or they need to deliver whatever product or services within the constraint of that particular project. Okay. And once these projects are delivered, it will be given to the program manager and he will integrate it with the other component. And then the program manager will transition those product and services to the operations to ensure that, you know, the operations team able to realize benefit from this particular product and services. Yeah. So primary responsibility of a project manager, of course, he also has to do some governance. He need to ensure whatever product he is delivering, the product is of a high quality. It is delivered within the schedule, within the cost, you know, so all within the all other constraint, that is what his governance responsibilities. Other stakeholder, as I said, like customer need to ensure that they provide necessary information, you know, do review meetings again with the program manager and the program management team to ensure that they are updated. They provide insight related to the requirement of their product and all. So that is the customer responsibility. You have vendor responsibilities and so on. So that's what we will discuss, more detail, maybe not part of this webinar, but if you're interested in this subject, program management subject, as part of the training, we'll talk more detail of each of these roles, each of their responsibilities and so on. Now, let us governance activities. This is the last slide we will cover and then we'll take your questions. Okay. There are many more things about the governance, how the governance is implemented. We have many slides of governance framework, but we will not able to take, this is what you need to attend our training, the program management training, to know more about the program governance and how the governance helps in delivering the benefit. That is what we will discuss more detail. Because this will take the entire day to cover the governance and so on. Some high level governance activities are phase gate reviews. Remember, it is the steering committee who will perform the multiple decision gate or phase gate. Phase gate are also called decision gate, where new component is authorized, existing component closure decisions are taken. And in this, decisions are only taken by the steering committee. So phase gate reviews are done primarily by the program steering committee, where the component go or no go decisions are taken. Okay. There can be n number of phase gate review in your program lifecycle, during the formulation phase, during the planning phase, during the delivery phase and so on. But the primary responsibility of the gate reviews is to authorize the first phase gate review will happen during the formulation phase, when your business case will get approved, when your charter will get approved. During the planning phase, the phase gate review will approve your program management plan and the associated subsidiary plan. During the delivery phase, the component charter will get authorized. During the delivery phase, new component will get authorized and so on. And if you could see authorization of a program and component, initiation and closure, these are only done during the phase gate review. You can't do during the health check review, program health check review, or a status review. During that, you can't, because they are not decision gates. Only the phase gate are also called decision gate, where the steering committee have to participate and take a decisions. Health check review, status review will be performed by the program manager between the two phase gate review to ensure that, you know, whatever phase gate review is planned, the objective of that phase gate review is fulfilled and so on. So authorization of a component will only happen during the phase gate reviews. Audits, there are various audits. Governance is all about audits also, financial audits, quality audits, process audits, documentation audits. Program governance need to ensure that all the document, the business case is the current, the charter is the current, the program management plan has been baselined whenever baselined and re-baselined whenever any new change has been authorized. So ensuring that all the document, doing configuration management, the version control system, all these things are some of the governance activities which will be performed the program lifecycle. Of course, financial audit to ensure that whatever the funding is allocated for the program is used effectively and efficiently. Escalated issues, risk, and change requests, these are all part of the program governance activities, friends. So friends, I hope now you understand what is the program. Program is all about related projects. And remember that the program are related with the benefit, not just by your same technology or same sponsor or same processes. The relation should be with a common benefit for the organization. Remember the importance of governance. What is the governance model and how governance is important for delivering the benefit, and whether the governance will be done only by the designated people in the governance board, or even the people, stakeholder, other than who are in the governance board, they also have the governance responsibilities. This is what we discussed in today's webinar. Okay, so friends, I hope you like this particular webinar. I would now, if you have any questions, I would like to take your question. You can just raise hand. There's a raise hand option. If you have any question, you can raise hand and I can take your question related to this particular subject. Anybody who has a question here? Okay, I have muted all of you. Okay, I will only unmute you if you have any specific question. Okay, so please do let me know, or you can also ask your question using the chat window. So you can start writing your question in the chat window, and I can take only one or two questions because of the time constraints and so on. So far there's no question. I hope, there's some question I could see from Sayed. I have no mic, no access to mic. Will add-on skill assist us in filing the program management application? Yes, Sayed, this is complete mentoring program where we will help you in your application, will help you in question bank, will help you in providing gap assessment session. And so we will ensure that you will get certified as a PGMP within 2 to 3 months of maximum time. Month, you have seen, if you follow us on the LinkedIn, you have seen how many people we are helping around the world to become PGMP certified, PFMP certified, PMP certified, and so on. So Sayed, my question is, my answer to you is, yes, we will help you in your application filing, explaining the entire concept. So it is not just passing the exam. This training will really help you to manage your day-to-day program management. You will get the confidence when you will know the concepts and so on. So that is what is the deliverables from this particular training. Yeah. When is the next intake going to start? I didn't understand the intake basically means. I can correlate this intake when the next webinar is going to happen. Very soon, which we may come. This session is related to the training session, Sayed. So you can visit addonskills.com. We have a training starting from 14th of April, I think so. So you can visit addonskills.com. You can search PGMP. And you will get the calendar and you can register for the PGMP on our website. So our next session is scheduled in this April month itself. So please go ahead and register for it. You can write to me at kailash@addonskills.com. I will able to respond to you, friends. Yeah. Okay, one or two more question maximum, friends, which we can take here now. Any other question which you have, anybody? I hope you liked some of the basic concept of this particular program management and the governance management. I hope it added some value to you. Okay, any other question, anybody? So I don't see, I don't think that people have any question here now. Okay. So friends, thank you. I would like to say thanks to each one of you who have attended this particular session here. Okay. There have been many people who have registered, but for either because of the time constraint, this is early morning here in India. Maybe they may be busy with other things, but yes, I will try to share the recordings and so on. So thank you. Please take care and have a great week ahead.